Once again, Christian greetings to all our valued listeners and viewers throughout the whole world, even more particularly to all Shepherd's Rod believers, and most especially to our beloved brothers and sisters in the United States of America. Special greetings to our brethren in Colorado, our brethren in Georgia, our brethren in Kansas, in Missouri, in Texas, and Chicago, Illinois. Our brethren in Fiji Island, Mexico, Spain, in Africa, Kenya, Zambia, Pakistan, to the United Kingdom, and also to our brethren in Australia, and to the rest of the 144,000 living saints scattered abroad. Greetings. May the good Lord bless you, brothers and sisters. This message is especially and directly addressed to all the living saints. This is our special episode number 2 on the subject, the opening of the seventh seal. And as we know, the seventh sealing period is concerned the living, according to 2 SR 202. But the seventh sealing period, being the last, must concern the living. So this message is especially and directly addressed to all the living saints scattered abroad, because the seventh seal, being the last seal, it pertains and concerns the living. And the voice of inspiration plainly telling us in 2 SR 220, saying, thus we conclude that when the seal is opened, pointing to the last seal, the seventh seal, thus we conclude that when the seal is opened and the judgment for the living begins, we must know it. So that is a divine command directly addressed to all the candidates to be among the living saints, that when the seal is opened and the judgment for the living begins, we must know it, indicating in absolute necessity to know it, brothers and sisters. And to repeat again, we are that people stated in 2 TG number 12, page 30, saying, to the people who must know that their cases are on trial. That statement cannot be applied to all the saints who are destined for grave and resurrection. That statement must be applied only to the saints that will no longer to taste death. That we individually need to know that our cases are on trial. And of course, the devil is determined to keep God's people in darkness concerning about it. Let's read again the statement in White House Recruiter, page 31 and page 32. Let us not, however, forget that there is an enemy who is determined to keep God's people in darkness, in ignorance of timely truth. And what more damaging darkness could he seek to keep them in than in ignorance of that which God would have them to know? While their judgment is pending, while they are being weighed in the balances of the sanctuary, none, absolutely none. Although the Shepherd's Rod told us that Satan knows how to deceive. In 2 SR page 105, it says, Satan knows how to deceive so that it cannot be easily detected. So Satan knows how to deceive, by which it cannot be easily detected. But we need also to know that God knows how to save. In 2 TG number 6, page 21, it says, God knows how to save. Saving is His chief concern. And since we do fully believe that God is more powerful than Satan, no one can hinder God's purpose, God's desire, it will triumph, however the vast amount of opposition. And since it was already predicted beforehand, according to 2 TG 24, page 23, saying, the church, therefore, will not sleep forever. The true people of God will awake to their poverty. They will profit at this rousing call. And without any doubts, that true people of God is pointing to the 144,000 living saints scattered abroad. God will awaken their senses and they will humbly admit that they were in deep spiritual poverty, meaning they were destitute of the present truth, by which such present truth is pointing to Christ's mediatorial work in the heavenly sanctuary. And the mere fact that not even one of God's servants in the United States of America had been able to know that we are now in the last year of provisionary time reveals the accuracy of the Word of God. That in such great apostasy, brothers and sisters, stated in Isaiah 63 verse 5 and also Isaiah 59:16 and Micah 7 verse 5, according to 1 SR 219. And 220. To the prophet Isaiah, this great apostasy, fostered by blind spiritual guides, was revealed, which he describes in the following scriptures. And that is Isaiah 59:16, Isaiah 63 verse 5, and Micah 7 verse 5. That according to 2TG 44 on page 38, that when that predicted event will be fulfilled, it says, in 2TG 44, page 38. Looking down to this very time, the spirit of prophecy in Isaiah's day said, Isaiah 63 verse 5. What is Isaiah 63 verse 5? Great apostasy, as is stated in 1 SR 219 and 220. And according to this reading, it says, here you know that when the time came, what time? The great apostasy. There was not even one among his servants to uphold the work of the harvest. And consequently, the Lord himself did the work without them. 2TG 44, page 38. Not even one among God's servants in the United States of America that been able to uphold the work of the harvest. And it is concerning the harvest that pertains to the living. By which, according to 2TG number 11, page 13, 2TG number 11, page 13, it says, other truths, even more important, must be introduced for the harvest of the living. So it is concerning the harvest of the living. I say more important truths because they are concerning the living themselves, concerning those whose own cases are to be weighed in the balances. You still remember our reading in White House Recruiter, page 32, that Satan is determined to keep God's people in darkness, in ignorance of timely truth. And there is no more damaging darkness that Satan could seek God's people in ignorance than to keep them in ignorance. What is going on in the heavenly sanctuary at the time when their cases are being weighed in the balances in the sanctuary? None, absolutely none. And according to that reading, it is God that wants them to know that their cases in the heavenly sanctuary are on trial. And reading again the statement in an Adventist Activities Research Committee on page 15, and how will he judge the living without a message declaring that their cases are now to appear before God? How God can judge the living without sending first a message declaring that their cases are now to appear before God? But the voice of inspiration says that God's agency on earth will be the one to proclaim that the event has actually taken place. And that is the spirit of prophecy in the church. 2TG number 12, page 29. The revelation, moreover, in the following verses again and again, endeavors to make us see that the event there portrayed is the judgment in session. John truly penned it as a prophecy, but when it actually takes place, then God's agency on earth, the spirit of prophecy in the church, is to proclaim that the event has actually taken place. And of all the messages ever recorded in the Bible, the proceedings that takes place in the heavenly sanctuary, that is the only truth by which God placed a divine code, which is unbreakable, that it cannot be counterfeited by the devil. Because the illustration in the Bible
Brothers and sisters, no man in heaven, nor in earth, nor under the earth, neither the angels, could be able to open that book except the lion in the tribe of Judah, and that is Jesus Christ. And we read already, according to 2 TG 44, page 30 and 31, that there is a divine code. And that even John the Revelator himself, who wrote the book of Revelation, he could not explain his own writings. The same with Daniel. According to the great controversy 344, that even the prophets who have been favored with God, with a special illumination of the Spirit. Now, brothers and sisters, the shepherd's rod declared clearly in 2 TG 24, page 16, are not these tests strong enough to convince any of you that it was guaranteed by God that concerning the proceedings in the heavenly sanctuary, even the devil either cannot be able to explain anything concerning about it. It cannot be counterfeited. And the voice of inspiration says, brothers and sisters, that at the time when it is revealed, we need to know that God himself is at work. Now, the most important for us is that we need to ask ourselves, what does the shepherd's rod teach us concerning the judgment for the living? Does our Almighty God will begin the proceedings in the judgment that pertains to the living, and the living themselves are ignorant and they have no knowledge of it, that their cases are already on trial in the heavenly sanctuary? Because there are many Davidians says, beware of this time setting. And I do fully believe that the time setting mentioned in the writings of Sister White, also in the writings of B.T. Hotep, is more directly addressed to the second visible coming of Jesus Christ, not to the commencement of the judgment that pertains to the living. Why not read again and again these passages that we read several times? That statement in 2 TG 12:29, saying that God's agency on earth, the spirit of prophecy in the church, is to proclaim that the event has actually taken place. Is it not a proclamation of the time that the judgment for the living is in progress? Now, the statement in 2SR 219 saying, while the judgment for the living is in progress, while the judgment for the living is in progress, every sin must be confessed and put away. He who would neglect this great privilege will find himself involved in everlasting ruin, cut off from among his people. Ignoring this most vital subject would not profit us in the least. This is one of the most vital subjects, to know when the judgment for the living is in progress. And how will we know that the judgment for the living is in progress? In Jesus' letter number 2, page 2, it says, how will we get the message of the judgment for the living? The answer is clear to all. We will get it in the same way we got the one in 1844. It is only true and by inspiration. Now, I would like to give an example, brothers and sisters, in the old symbolic code. Here in the old symbolic code, saying, 3 symbolic code number 2, page 2. 3 symbolic code number 2, page 2. Everyone who takes an active part in proclaiming the message of the investigative judgment becomes by this very fact not only a Seventh-day Adventist, but also a member of the Laodicean Church, the very name of which Laodicea signifies her work, which is that of making known to the world that the judgment is in session. 3 symbolic code number 2, page 2. Making to the world, to know the whole world, that the judgment is in session. But what judgment by which the Seventh-day Adventist Church did proclaim, by which such judgment was in session? Judgment that pertains to the dead. But the judgment that pertains to the living is even more important. And that's why the shepherd's rod says in 2SR 220, it says, if God so faithfully revealed to the living the commencement of the judgment for the dead, it cannot be possible that he would keep secret the time of the judgment for the living. If he did, we would have no present truth in the time of the last seal, which is the seventh seal. Neither could there be justice in such secrecy, nor could such judgment be legal. So that statement perfectly corroborating to the statement in an Adventist Activities Research Committee on page 15 saying, and how well he judged the living without a message declaring that their cases are now to appear before God. If you will say, brothers and sisters, that this message did not come from God, then we break the divine code. We have been able to explain. Whereas the Bible is very plain that this portion can never be counterfeited. Some will say, you have many dates that you proclaim previously by which it did not materialize. And I cannot even imagine why professing shepherds or believers cannot understand that those experiences are found in prophecy, that God's people will experience delays. The comparison is very plain, very plain. There are two midnight cries. The first midnight cry, they experienced disappointment. They did not experience delays, as stated by the shepherd's rod. I would like to read, again, 11 symbolic code, number 12, page 9. It says, 11 symbolic code, number 12, page 9. I suppose you would say they were the Millerites. If you will say that the Millerites experienced delay, if I will ask who experienced delay, then B.T. Hotep says, I suppose you would say that they were the Millerites. But to this, I cannot agree, because there was no delay for them. They had set the date for Christ's coming, and the outcome for them was not a delay, but a bitter disappointment. 11 symbolic code, number 12, page 9. There was no delay that had been experienced by the Millerites movement, but rather disappointment. But it was predicted beforehand that the midnight cry must be repeated again. In actuality, it is directly applied to the judgment that pertains to the living, as stated in 2SR 181. For example, I said 2SR 181. The midnight cry was first proclaimed prior to 1844. And that message must be repeated, by which it is directly applied to the living. But the fact is that they will experience delays, and that is our experience, by which the Bijan repeatedly saying that we are false messengers because we set dates and it was not materialized. Although we have given them abundance of proofs that God's people will experience delays. Now let us read again the statement in the Great Controversy. Great Controversy 392. It says, no one, however, did notice that an apparent delay in the accomplishment of the vision, a tarrying time, is presented in the same prophecy. So there is an apparent delay, but we did not know it after the events. The same with the experience of the Millerites movement. But the only difference with the Millerites movement, they did not experience delays. What they did experience is disappointment. But we experienced delays. But at this time, we are sure 100% that we are now in the time when God declared there will be no more delay. Here in the Great Controversy 393, it says, this had a personal experience, a faith in God and His Word, which could not be overthrown by disappointment and delay. You see, there are two experiences. The Millerites movement, they experienced disappointment. But the last and the final movement, they will experience delay. But they will never be discouraged for that, because it was already recorded in the Bible. It was explained by the spirit of prophecy. Now, I would like to read again the statement, brethren, given by the voice of inspiration. Let us read. That God's people will experience delay. And their experience, I would like to read that reading. Let's read the statement. Cannot disprove that their messages are not true. I would like to read this reading. If they had made a mistake as to their calculations of the exact day in which they expected the event to occur, it does not disprove the doctrine. Why? Because it is purposed by God that they will experience delay. What is delay? Miscalculations. It was allowed by God. If they have made a mistake as to their calculations of the exact day in which they expected the event to occur, it does not disprove the doctrine. Only the opposer says that, brothers and sisters, that we are false messengers. Then it says, it only subjects them to greater trials and urges them to exert one another, and so much the more as they see the day approaching. Now, I would like to plead to all the honest in heart, because this message is not addressed to those who oppose. It is addressed to them, to those who believe. Now, brothers and sisters, let us ponder deeply, brethren. The true people of God will experience delays. In Testimonies for the Church, Volume 2, 192, it says, the Lord intimates delays. Also, in Christ's Object Lesson, here in Christ's Object Lesson, the voice of inspiration is very plain. It says, 406, but there is a delay. So, it was predicted beforehand that God's people will experience delay. And such delay is in the period of the judgment that pertains to the dead. Now, I would like to focus our attention to the judgment for the dead and the judgment for the living. The praise, the judgment for the dead, as well as judgment for the living, the proceedings is in the holy place. If the proceedings is in the most holy place, that is judgment of the dead and judgment of the living, we should not mix up the preposition of and the preposition for. Now, let us read again the statement in 2 SR 164. It says, unless the close of the judgment for the dead, unless the close of the judgment for the dead and the commencement for the living be made known to us, we would have no present truth while the judgment for the living is in session. What is the description when the judgment for the living is in progress? Every sin must be confessed and put away. 2 SR 219. While the judgment for the living is in progress, every sin must be confessed and put away, indicating provisionary time. But the shepherd says, unless the close of the judgment for the dead will be made known to us, then there is no possibility that we could understand when the judgment for the living begins. Because the judgment for the living begins after the judgment for the dead is finished. That is very plain, brothers and sisters. But the shepherds have declared clearly, therefore we must conclude that when the seal is open and the judgment for the living begins, we must know it. Why is it that Bethihotep has no knowledge when the judgment for the living begins? Why is it? The first answer is that because the scripture is inscribed in present tense. Fear God and give glory to Him, for the hour of His judgment is come. Revelation 14 verse 7. And according to the shepherd's rod, and since it is God who commanded John the Beloved to write the book of Revelation, being inscribed in present tense, it says in 1 SR 156 and 157, God did not intend to make the judgment known until after the hour had come. For this reason, inspiration inscribed the occurrence in present tense is come in order to be grammatically correct. Bethihotep died even before the commencement of the judgment for the living begins. Then there is no possibility that Bethihotep could understand when the judgment for the living begins. Otherwise, such revelation would be grammatically incorrect. And he himself declared clearly in Answerer number 1, page 94 and 95. It says, in the statement in question, the rod has no reference to the investigative judgment. The message sits no date, either exact or approximate. What message that sits no date? The message of antitypical Elijah, John the Baptist. Because his work is only to proclaim what is the great and dreadful day of the Lord. Not when the great and dreadful day of the Lord. Because the great and dreadful day of the Lord, the judgment for the living, is inscribed in present tense. And that's the reason why in General Conference, page 10 and 11, that without this knowledge, when and what the great and dreadful day of the Lord itself is, we cannot discern Elijah. Because there are only two Elijahs, John the Baptist and Elijah the Tishbite. Therefore, there must only two antitypical Elijah. Antitypical Elijah, John the Baptist, that is Bethahotep. He himself stated boldly in 1 TJ 36, page 4, that he was antitypical Elijah, John the Baptist. And also stated in 1 Symbolic Code, number 4, page 5, that John was a type of the Elijah that is to come before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. And that is Bethahotep. But Elijah the Tishbite, he will be the one to proclaim the day. So here the statement given in Answerer number 1, pages 94 and page 95, it says, the message sets no date, either exact or approximate, for the closing of the judgment of the dead and for the beginning of the judgment of the living. The time of the cessation of the one event and the beginning of the other is not to be known until the one is past and the other begun. What is the one is past? The judgment for the dead is past. The judgment for the dead is finished. And after the judgment for the dead is finished, then that is the time that God would reveal to his people the judgment for the living is in progress, inscribed in present tense. Now, what is our absolute proof? What is our absolute proof that the judgment for the dead, it was finished already on April 1, 2020? And from April 2, 2020, the judgment for the living is in progress and it will be finished on March 27, 2021. The climactic event, the blotting out of names, all those who failed to receive the seal of the living God, the first view of the sealing of the 144,000, as foretold in tract number 1, page 19 and page 20, that the sealing of the 144,000 is in twofold view. And we are talking about now the first view, the sealing of the 144,000 in the heavenly sanctuary, in the holy place, by which all the names that failed to obtain the seal of the living God, their names will be blotted out this coming Day of Atonement. And that is the reason why there is an urgency of this message. Now, I would like to read, brothers and sisters, tract number 3 on page 20. Tract number 3 on page 20. It says, plainly, therefore, the judgment is to begin and the sanctuary to be cleansed, not before, but after the fulfillment of the period of those appointed to die. That statement, brethren, appointed to die, indicates that their cases had been judged in the heavenly sanctuary while living. And they were appointed to die. You cannot use the statement appointed to die if such person are already dead. Now, I would like to read to you a statement in tract number 15. In reality, my dear brothers and sisters, there are plenty of subjects, prophetic subjects, that had been graciously placed by God in our hands. But the reason why I'm emphasizing greatly this coming Day of Atonement, because after this Day of Atonement, there is a door that will close. Although there is also a door that will be opened. If you remember that statement in Testimonies for the Church, volume 9, page 97, by which also it was quoted in the writings of the Shepherd's Rod on the Old Symbolic Code. When the Shepherd's Rod says, let me read to you, that the door is closed, 2 Symbolic Code, number 12, page 8. 2 Symbolic Code, number 12, page 8. It says, sorrow to one, joy to another. The same with the statement, right, in tract number 1, page 29 and page 30. Culminating in joy, mourning, and woe. And it says, sorrow to one, joy to another. If you will read, I'm reading 2 Symbolic Code number 12, page 8. If you will read 1 Ezra 227 and 228, it says, that important event is none other than the purification of God's church and the separation of the tares from the wheat. Say Jesus, let both grow together until the harvest. The separation will mark the harvest. Note the verb until, meaning up to. This most solemn time for the one class, the tares.
Why is it that the shepherd son says that? It is a very solemn time to all of them whose names will be blotted out.
But glorious for the other, the 144,000. 1 SR 227 and 228. It is a very solemn time.
And the description given in the Bible that the 144,000,
they follow the Lamb whithersoever He goeth. Revelation 14,
I think that is verse 4.
Let me read to you the statement in the Great Controversy.
Let us read the statement given by the voice of inspiration.
430 on the Great Controversy. It is those who by faith follow Jesus in the great work of the atonement, who receive the benefits of His mediation in their behalf, while those who reject the light which brings to view this work of ministration are not benefited thereby. Here's another statement that I would like to read to you, brothers and sisters. And I think that is the description of the 144,000 living saints. They follow the Lamb whithersoever He goeth. Here in the Great Controversy, page 432, they saw that their great high priest had entered upon another work of ministration, and following him by faith, they were led to see also the closing work of the church. So, from closing work for the church to closing work of the church. Look at this reading published by the so-called Bayesian movement. Let me read to you, by which they call it tract number 16. It says, tract number 16, page 33. This, the 144,000, are they which follow the Lamb whithersoever He goeth. They follow Him as truth progresses. Hence, they followed Him as it progressed during His work in the sanctuary for the judgment of the dead, and they faithfully follow Him on as His ministerial work changes to the judgment of the living. Thus they follow Him on in victory to Mount Zion. That is the 144,000 living saints. They focus all their concentration to the occurrence that takes place in the heavenly sanctuary, but Satan is deceiving God's people by focusing their attention to prove what is the true headquarters, while in reality, they were in total ignorance what is going on in the heavenly sanctuary. That is the reality, brethren. And not only that, they fight against this proclamation. They were so angry with this message. Now, I would like to read first this reading in 1 SR. 1 SR 234. If any should think this message for reformation is false, while he cannot find prophecy against it, would be saying God has overlooked the danger and has failed to expose the scheme. Therefore, such a one means to say that God knows but little in predicting the future. But the matter of fact is that God knows it from the beginning to the end. Thus, He has been able to present a message of warning such as this to His people, inscribed in advance for thousands of years. Now, I plead to all the obedient, since you fully believe the Shepherd's Rod publications, is there any warning given by the Shepherd's Rod that any who would proclaim concerning the commencement of the judgment for the living, run away from him? Do not believe him. It is cometh from the devil. Is there any statement in the Shepherd's Rod? Because God knoweth already beforehand what will happen in the last days. If you could not find any statement in the Shepherd's Rod, brethren, think it thoroughly. Because the statement in the Shepherd's Rod is quite opposite. It was guaranteed by the Shepherd's Rod that before Jesus Christ will begin the atonement for the living, there must be a message of present truth, which is the heavenly summons. 2 SR 164. And the voice of inspiration is saying, an Adventist Activities Research Committee How will he judge the living without a message declaring that their cases are now to appear before God? Would the judge of heaven condemn one without trial? And how shall he judge him without summons? How our Almighty God will begin the atonement for the living without sending heavenly summons? Is there any statement in the shepherd's rod that there is a counterfeit heavenly summons? Ponder deeply, brethren. It is a life and death matter. Every day, the time is getting shorter and shorter, my dear fellow obedience. Now, I would like to read again the statement here. And to symbolic code, number 12, page 8. Sorrow to one, joy to another. It says, please give us light on the following testimony, or that the people might know the time of their visitation, the time of God's destructive judgment is the time of mercy for those who have had no opportunity to learn what is truth. Tenderly will the Lord look upon them. His heart of mercy is touched. His hand is still stretched out to save, while the door is closed to those who would not enter. Testimonies for the Church, Volume 9, page 97. Answer. The above testimony shows that God is to manifest His destructive judgments before the close of provision. Now, if it points to the church, it must be the slaughtering before the close of provision. According to 3 symbolic code, number 1, page 8. Saying, therefore, as there are two separations, there is a double fulfillment of Ezekiel's slaughter. One in the church before the close of provision, and the other in the worldly churches after the close of provision. Now the question is, how can we avoid such distractions that fall upon the sinners in the church? The answer given in the shepherd's rod is definite. In 1 TG number 6, on page 38, it says, it is obvious that they escape the distraction of these sinners in the church. Who are they? Only the holy ones, those whose names are left written in the book, escape the destruction that falls upon the wicked in the church. Only they constitute the remnant, the ones that are left. 1 TG number 6, page 38. Now, brothers and sisters, the Bible teaches, the golden bowl teaches that probationary time will close first to the church, to the professed people of God. How much more to us, professed obedient, because we have more knowledge than any other denominations. Now, let's go back to our study. I did not proclaim this message to force anyone. The command, divine command given by God to Ezekiel, proclaim the message, whether they will hear or forbear, because they were a rebellious house, according to Ezekiel chapter 2. And the only reason that we proclaim this message because we are commanded by God. And we will leave all the consequences in the hands of God. As long as my desire, my goal, my wish is to prepare everybody, then I leave all the judgment in the hands of God. Because we have only one judge, and that is God. James chapter 4, verse 12. Now, since the shepherd's rod already declared that when the judgment for the living begins, we must know it. 2 SR 220. And how will we know? I remember the statement in an Adventist Activities Research Committee, page 15. It says, and how will we know when it comes if we keep our eyes and ears closed? If we do not change our present state of mind, how shall we believe even if we should accidentally hear that the message is come? But the answer, how will we know? The only way to know it is through Jesus Christ. Only Jesus Christ can give the absolute information. And that information, according to 2 TG 1229, is channeled through God's agency on earth. There is an agency of God. And that is the spirit of prophecy in the church is the one to proclaim that the event has actually taken place. The judgment for the living is in session. The judgment for the living is in progress. And it is about finish. The obedient, in reality, they have no knowledge that judgment for the living, that is the proceedings in the holy place, and judgment of the living, that is proceedings in the most holy place. Why? Because it was foretold by the word of God 1,000 years ago that when the judgment for the living commence, there is not even one among his servants to uphold the work of the harvest that pertains to the living. 2 TG 44, page 38. And I need to believe what God has said in his word. I need to absolutely believe the written word of God. If you will say that there is someone in the United States of America that had been able to uphold the work of the harvest, then we are saying that God is a liar. And it is impossible. God is not a man that he should lie. That's what it means to have the righteousness of Christ. According to 2 TG 35 on page 6, God's righteousness, you see, is his integrity, his sure promises, his might to perform. He guarantees his promises. They never fail. To have the righteousness of the Lord, therefore, is to have his integrity and faithfulness. And this we can never have so long as we mistrust him. Never so long as we doubt his word. For to doubt is nothing short of calling him a liar. To doubt is the greatest offense one can commit. 2 TG 35, page 6. That is the lowest common denominator. One. Not even one. If there is one, God would not say it. Not even one among his servants been able to uphold the work of the harvest. 2 TG 44, page 38. Now, we already read in tract number 3, page 20, that the judgment mentioned there is the judgment that pertains to the living, will not begin, not until the cases of those who are appointed to die is finished. Brethren, in tract number 5, hoping that you will read these paragraphs or these pages, 109 and 110, I will just explain to minimize time. Tract number 5, 109, 110, beginning the temple and the altar, inanimate objects, then up to 110 and 111. That in that pages, 109, 110, and 111, there are only 3 classes to be judged. Where? In the holy place. Because if you will be saying that the great multitude will not be judged in the most holy place, then their sins will not be blotted out. Because the only judgment that takes place in the most holy place is blotting out of sins and granting of rewards. That before they will be rewarded, their sins must be blotted out first. That is in 2 SR 189, right? The proceedings that pertains to the most holy place. It says, during Christ's ministration in the holiest of all, which is a throne of judgment, of blotting out sins and granting of rewards, that is the proceedings in the most holy place. And the only names to be brought into the most holy place are the names of the righteous. Those names that had been inscribed into the Lamb's Book of Life, sealed with 7 seals. It says here, in 2 SR 192, only those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life are brought into the presence of God in the most holy place. What Lamb's Book of Life? In the next paragraph, the book sealed with 7 seals in the right hand of the great judge must contain the names of those whose sins are to be blotted out. And the only sins to be blotted out are the sins of the righteous. And it was also stated in 2 SR 199. 2 SR 199. The book containing the names of all the righteous beginning with Adam and unto the close of probation, the end of the gospel, 7 seals. The book containing all the names of the righteous. And what is the statement given by the shepherd's rod? In 2 SR page 184, the virgins were called to meet him and thus by faith go in with him to appear before the Father, the great judge. The seal is the permit. There is a permit to enter into the most holy place. And what is the permit? The seal. it places their names in the Lamb's Book of Life. Lamb's Book of Life of what? Sealed with seven seals. And thus it grants to them the right to appear before the Father in the judgment, not in person, but in figure, thus having their sins blotted out, pointing to the most holy place. Who are they that can enter the most holy place? Only those who receive the seal of the living God. So the sealing precedes the coming of Jesus Christ to the most holy place. And that is the sealing that takes place on the holy place. There are three aspects of sealing. Sealing by Jesus Christ, or sealed by Jesus Christ, sealed by the Holy Spirit, and sealed by God the Father. The sealing of Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit takes place in the holy place. But the sealing, which is of God the Father, takes place in the most holy place. The Trinity. But if we fail the sealing that takes place in the holy place, there is no more chance for us to the sealing in the most holy place. And that is why Jesus Christ says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man can come to the Father but by me. We cannot come to the Father in the most holy place if we fail to receive the seal of Jesus Christ. Now, I would like to read this statement, brethren, in 2SR 162. 2SR 162. It says, the cases of all who are sealed from 1929 to the final close of provision will be investigated before the throne in the heavenly sanctuary while living. 2SR 118. Grammatical rule is followed in the scriptures, and it is one way to recognize present truth. 2SR 118. If you will read 1SR 244, it says that when the appointed time is come, the grammar is perfect. It says here in 1SR 244, it says the statement given, it is wonderful to note the inspiration of the scriptures. Perfect they are when their appointed time is come. Only at such an occasion are the scriptures grammatically correct. Here's another statement that I would like to read in the Shepherd's Rod. Three symbolic code, number 7, page 4. Three symbolic code, number 7, page 4. You yourself know that such careless and thoughtless interpretations, which pay no attention to language and which obey neither rule nor logic, are not inspired but are private and thus inevitably false. Any explanation, any interpretation by which do not pay attention to the grammatical rule, it is inevitably false. Now, what does it mean by the word while living? Now, let us read track number 9, page 10. Track number 9, page 10. The words while, the earth remaineth, expressly denoting limitation of time. So the word while, expressly denoting limitation of time. So the statement while living must be applied only to the saints who are appointed to die. The statement in track number 3, page 20. The last constituent of the sixth seal represented by the altar. Who are they? Those who will die after the sealing of the 144,000. That their cases are already finished before they died. They were judged in the heavenly sanctuary while living. So let us read again the statement here in 2SR 162. Of course, brothers and sisters, if you will say that the cases of all who are sealed from 1929 is pointing to all the obedience, then how could you explain the reality? Because at this time, they were already dead. But the statement says, they will be investigated in the heavenly sanctuary while living. The question is that, when does the investigation of them in the heavenly sanctuary takes place, by which they are investigated in the heavenly sanctuary while living, while they were still alive? When? Now let us continue reading in 2SR 162. The investigation commences after the fulfillment of Ezekiel 9. Now the absolute answer given by the shepherd's rod, when does the investigation of the saints, those appointed to die, that their cases in the heavenly sanctuary will be investigated while living? When? After the fulfillment of Ezekiel 9. So that statement is very plain. after the fulfillment of Ezekiel 9. Brothers and sisters, there are many statements in the Shepherd's Rod by which the Shepherd's Rod called it fulfillment of Ezekiel 9, by which cannot be applied to one period of time, different periods. But the only period of time by which the statement in 2SR 162 that the cases of the last constituent of the altar, who are they? Revelation 14:13. When will Revelation 14:13 die? After the sealing of the 144,000. Now let us read 1 2SR 173. Revelation 14:13. Blessed are the dead. 2SR 173. Blessed are the dead which die in the Lord from henceforth. Yes, saith the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors, and their works do follow them. Revelation 14:13. Which die from henceforth, that is, from the commencement of the loud cry. Thus the word declares that some of the saints will be laid in the grave even during the time of the harvest loud cry. We quote from the Councils on Health, page 375. Many will be laid away to sleep before the fiery ordeal of the time of trouble shall come upon the world. In 1 SR 219 it says, let's read 1 SR 219. And I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, write, blessed are the dead which die in the Lord from henceforth. Note that after the sealing of the 144,000, there would be some who would die in the Lord, meaning saved. For the scripture reads, from henceforth, meaning from the time this company was sealed. Past tense, from the time this company was sealed. Now, I would like to show in a simple illustration such a statement. So let us make a simple diagram, brothers and sisters. Now, the altar, they are those who died under the sixth seal, the last seal that pertains to the dead. Of course, it commenced in October 22, 1844. Now, let us put here, October 22, 1844. The constituent of the altar, sixth seal, is divided into two. I would like to say at this time, two periods of time. Isaiah 57:1 and Revelation 14:13. What is Isaiah 57:1? Those who died before the evil time is come. What is the evil time? Great tribulation, not time of trouble. Because at the commencement of the time of trouble, there will be no more saint to die. Now, I would like to put here great tribulation. What is the statement? During the great tribulation, the 144,000 was completely sealed. The 144,000 living saints, spiritual Israel, was completely sealed. Was sealed. That is the statement given on 1 SR 219. But at that time, there are saints to die. Who are they? Revelation 14:13. They will die martyr. They will be martyred for their faith. Because there are three martyr dooms, as the exceeding great horn had three stages. Pagan Rome, Papal Rome, and then American Rome, or the Protestant period. So there are three martyr dooms. The souls under the altar, talking about Revelation 6, verse 9 and 10, they are those who died under pagan Rome. Fellow servants, those who died during the Dark Ages. Fellow brethren, that is still future, and that is Revelation 14:13. Therefore, brothers and sisters, the constituent of Revelation 14:13, they were just before the commencement of the Great Tribulation. Because during the Great Tribulation, that is the time that they will die. But their cases are already finished, brothers and sisters, while they were still alive. Judged while living. Destined to die. But the question, when? After the fulfillment of Ezekiel 9. 2SR, page 162. And there is no other event by which that statement after the fulfillment of Ezekiel 9, none other than, brothers and sisters, that diagram of B.T. Hodap. Let us go to the diagram of the 12 figurative months. That is, you see, five. Brothers and sisters, here you can see how perfect is our Almighty God. You can see here five. What is five? The expiration of the five symbolical months. And that is between October and September. Therefore, that is September 16. Then you can see fulfillment of Ezekiel 9. So here, brothers and sisters, if we could be able to locate when does the expiration of the fulfillment of Ezekiel 9, then after the expiration of the fulfillment of Ezekiel 9, that is the time by which the commencement of the proceedings of those who are appointed to die. They were judged while living. But where is the proceedings? Holy place? Most holy place. Let us locate first, brothers and sisters, that predicted event. Now let us go back to track number 5. Page 74. Let's read. The fact too that the trumpets are figurative is another evidence that these 5 months are figurative time. But why should this period in which the locusts, the Christians, have power to torment men be limited to 5 months? It says, it will be noted that the 144,000 are called the first fruits, denoting that they are sealed at the beginning of the harvest, the commencement of the time to separate the tares from the wheat. To the parable of the harvest, then we must go for the full explanation of the 5 months period. What kind of explanation? Full explanation of the 5 months period. How? In what way that we could obtain the full understanding, the full explanation of the 5 months period? By studying the parable of the harvest. Then it says in the next paragraph, in track number 3, the harvest, the time from the baptism of Christ to the close of provision is shown to be illustrated by 12 figurative months, 6 from Christ's baptism to his crucifixion, 5 from the crucifixion to the ingathering of the first fruits, the 144,000, Revelation 14 verse 4, leaving 1 month for the ingathering of the second fruits, the great multitude, Revelation 7 verse 9. It is a wonderful subject, the 12 figurative months. But in order for us to comprehend completely the 12 figurative months, according to that reading, by which the particular object in view is the 5 figurative months, to find the full explanation concerning about the subject, we need to study closely the parable of the harvest. And the shepherd's rod definitely mentioned track number 3. And only this reading material, track number 3, by which there are different editions. The other called 3rd edition, the other called 1934 edition, and track number 3 itself. Now let us read track number 3. Let us read track number 3 on page 54. Track number 3 on page 54. The seed sower, I would like to read in the upper portion. Track number 3, page 54. Important as it is, any who would fail to make a diligent and careful study of the nature and significance of this great work of God's investigating the guests who have come in for the wedding are simply indifferent to the prospects of eternal life, so great salvation. Remember, brethren, this statement is directly applied to the living rather than to the dead. And in track, I think that is track number 1, saying on page 25, the investigation and casting out takes place before probation closes. For the marriage ceremony had not yet been performed at the time that the king came in to see the guests. Now, where is the marriage ceremony to be performed? Most holy place. So this statement can be easily understood that this investigation is in the holy place. Casting out, because there is no casting out in the most holy place. The divine principle is that the only one that can enter the most holy place are the righteous, those who receive the seal of the living God. Then there is no casting out in the most holy place. The casting out must be in the holy place. Now let us read again the statement here. It says, this investigation and casting out, that is Matthew 22 verse 11 and verse 13, takes place before probation closes. For the marriage ceremony had not yet been performed Or in other words, this investigation and casting out takes place before probation closes. And at the time when Jesus Christ is in the holy place, before Jesus Christ entered to the most holy place, by which the marriage ceremony had to be performed. And what is the statement given in the Bible? The man is speechless. I would like to read 1 SM 330. 1 SM page 330. It says, the statement given by the voice of inspiration. The reason that the man is speechless, because he knoweth. I could not find a statement here. Matthew 22 on verse, page 80. I will get to page 80. 1 SM page 80. It says, let's read a statement. The garment provided for him at great cost, he disdained to wear. To the king's demand, how camest thou in hither not having a wearing garment? He could answer nothing. He was speechless, for he was self-condemned. Why? Because he knew it, brothers and sisters. And that is pointing to the heavenly summons. He who failed to receive or to respond to the heavenly summons will be left without the seal or covering of God. Why is it that they were speechless? Because they knew it, they heard it, but they turned a deaf ear to the message. Now I would like to read track number 3, pages 52 and page 53. Track number 3, page 52 and 53. Those on the other hand whose names shall be blotted out of the books are those who shall have failed to put on the wedding garment. Matthew 22 verse 11. At the master's command, verse 13, there shall be cast out nevermore to be among the wedding guests. Remember the statement, blotted out of the books. And then it says in last paragraph, this startling revelation shows conclusively that the cleansing according to Daniel 8 verse 14 is first of the sanctuary in heaven and second of the sanctuary on earth. Track number 3, page 52 and page 53. Now, let us now go back to our subject. Unless we know when the judgment for the dead will close. Of course, to know the judgment for the dead close is also to know the commencement of the judgment for the living. Because after the judgment for the dead close, immediately commence the judgment for the living. The statement given in 2SR 164 saying, I would like to read, while the investigation for the congregation of the dead is in progress, there can be no separation among the congregation of the living. But it is pointing to the first aspect of the judgment takes place in heaven. And you can read that in answerer number 5 on page 30. Saying, according to Jesus' parable, this work takes place in the time of harvest, the end of the world. And as the congregation of the dead, as well as the congregation of the living, are commingled with the good and the bad, the judgment takes place among both. First among the dead, then among the living. Then it says, this is the first aspect of the judgment, and being only a bookwork, a work that does not disturb either the dead in the graves or the living in the church, it takes place in heaven. What is the statement in the great controversy 490? Those whose names are blotted out are unconscious to the fact that their cases are already forever fixed. It could no longer be altered. Although there is no material side, because the only reason that the saints, they knew that the blotting out of names are already finished, it is only by faith. And the wicked, they did not believe the message. They don't accept the message. Therefore, how could they obtain faith? Although it is a great privilege, because that is the statement given by the spirit of prophecy. They are privileged to see by faith what is going forward in the heavenly sanctuary. 4 BC 1139. So the statement in 2SR 164 saying, while the investigation for the congregation of the dead is in progress, can be easily discerned that while the investigation for the congregation of the dead are still unfinished, then the investigation among the congregation of the living cannot begin. So the statement in answerer number 1, page 94 and page 95 is easy to understand, saying the one is past and the other begun. The one is finished, then the other begun. Now, how we get such information that the judgment that pertains to the dead in the holy place was finished in April 1, 2020. God provide us infallible proofs. If I say infallible proofs, meaning it happens only once in a lifetime. It never happens. Because if it is the occurrences happens every now and then it will be, there must be a hard time to conclude that that is infallible proof. The first infallible proof, brothers and sisters, and I invite all the obedient to study closely. The infallible proof is, according to the voice of inspiration, is the new moon. From one new moon to another new moon, heavenly bodies is controlled by God. Now let us read again the statement, saying, I am inclined to believe. So let us read. I am inclined to believe that those who watch for the day and hour will understand both before they arrive. Paul says, Hebrews chapter 10 verse 25, exhorting one another, and so much the more as ye see the day approaching, which seems to imply that it may be seen before it actually arrives. Our Lord says, Revelation 3 verse 3, if therefore thou shalt not watch, I will come on you as a thief, and thou shalt not know what hour I will come upon thee. Which implies that if we will watch, we shall know what hour. It appears to me probable that the blowing of trumpets in the seventh month, in the first day of the month, Leviticus 23 verse 24, is to be understood as a type of something that is to occur on that day, which will be a signal to those who are watching to show them that the seventh month has commenced. It may be the literal sounding of the seventh trumpet. If not that, something that God's people who are watching will understand and then know for a certainty when the tenth day is. Psalms 81 verse 3, blow up the trumpet in the new moon, the first day of the seventh month, in the time appointed on our solemn feast day. I think that blowing of trumpets means something that we shall very soon understand. The Lord help us to stand on our watchtower. You see, Psalms 81 verse 3, without inspiration, I did not even know that the solemn feast day mentioned there is the Day of Atonement. And of all the feasts recorded in the Shepherd's Rod, it is the Day of Atonement by which the Shepherd's Rod says, urges Judah. I would like to read 1 TG number 3 on page 15. 1 TG number 3, page 15. It says, thus urging Judah. But I do fully believe it points out to the 144,000. Because only the 144,000 will listen to this message. To the rest, they will only bring condemnation upon themselves because they will reject the message. The foolish virgins, they will reject the message. Now, I would like to read 1 TG 3:15. Thus urging Judah the church to keep this antitypical atonement feast. What feast? That the message urges so that God's people will keep the antitypical atonement, the final day of atonement, and to perform her vows to God so as to be found worthy of escaping the judgment of God. Who are they worthy to escape the judgment of God? 1 TG 6:38, those whose names have been left written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Hence, God's plea to His church is now ringing throughout the land, saying, awake, awake, put on thy strength, O Zion, put on thy beautiful garments, O Jerusalem, the holy city, for henceforth there shall no more come unto thee the uncircumcised and unclean. Isaiah 52 verse 1. That is pointing to March 27, 2021. From that time onwards, there will no more wicked, there will be no more names of the wicked to be inscribed in the Lamb's Book of Life. Thus urging Judah to keep this antitypical atonement feast. Now, how can we for sure 100% that this March 27, 2021 Gregorian calendar, in Bible calendar, that is October 10, 2022, that is the final and the last Day of Atonement, blotting out of names, no longer the congregation among the dead, but rather the congregation among the living, but only pertaining to the professed people of God, the people under the banner of the third angel's message. Not to the whole world, not to the great multitude, how much more particularly to all shepherds or believers. And our aim, our goal, our prayer, that if possible, not even one among professed shepherds or believers, that their names will be blotted out on that very day, although they were vehemently opposed this message. Still we love them. Still we pray for them. Because our desire is to save. Now, ponder deeply, brothers and sisters. We can prove to you at least three infallible proofs. The first infallible proof is found in the book of Ezekiel. Ezekiel 45, verse 18. So let us read again that statement in the book of Ezekiel. Ezekiel 45, verse 18. So let us read the statement. It says, "Thus saith the Lord God, in the first month," so that is April, "in the first day of the month," so that is April 1, "thou shalt take a young bullock without blemish and cleanse the sanctuary." Can any Davidian explain Ezekiel 45 verse 18? Of course, no one can explain it except Ezekiel, because God delegates no other to be watchman of God's people except Ezekiel, right? In 1 TG, God delegates no other to be watchman to his people except Ezekiel. 1 TG 22:30. Aside from Ezekiel, God's mouthpiece, God delegates no other to be a watchman of the people. And this is the very message of Ezekiel. To inform the brethren that 1,000 years ago, it was predicted beforehand that in Gregorian calendar, April 1, that is Day of Atonement in Bible calendar. And it never happens ever since. Only in 2020, April 1, 2020, Gregorian calendar, in Bible calendar, that is October 10, 2021. For sure, it could not be Bible calendar. Isaiah 45:18. What is the cleansing of the sanctuary? Day of Atonement. All the passages, Bible, writings of Sister White, writings of B.T. Hotep, the only day but it's called cleansing of the sanctuary is the Day of Atonement. There is no other day. It says here, 2 SR 187, it says, it was called the Day of Atonement, judgment, or cleansing of the sanctuary. 2 SR 187, as a matter of fact, we can give you even more than 20 passages, but two passages is enough. It says here, on 218 in 2 SR, "Thus the Day of Antitypical Atonement, judgment, or cleansing of the sanctuary." But why is it Isaiah 45:18 says that the cleansing of the sanctuary takes place in April 1, first day of the first month? Because it is a prophecy, infallible proof. And we did not know that it was found in the book of Ezekiel, not until after the event. That is infallible proof, brethren. April 1, 2020, that is the last and the final Day of Atonement in the holy place that pertains to the dead. Then after that event, commence the judgment for the living. If you will say investigative judgment in the heavenly sanctuary, that is prior to the Day of Atonement. Because Day of Atonement, that is already the executive judgment. That after such investigation, those who fail to receive to the seal of the living God, their names will be blotted out on that Day of Atonement. Who are they that will be cut off on the Day of Slaughter? Tract number 3, page 73, it says, "The day in which the Lord will blot from his book the names of all sinners and cut off from the congregation of his people all whose names are not in the book." So plenty of passages in abundance that the blotting out of names takes place before the destruction. And only those whose names had been left written in the Lamb's Book of Life will be spared in that destruction. That's destructions of the sinners in the church. When would be the destruction of the sinners in the church? Passover week. Passover week. When would be the blotting out of names? Day of Atonement. How many months from the Day of Atonement to the Passover week? 6 months. So brothers and sisters, as we repeated several times, brethren, that the material side is on the Passover week, not on the Day of Atonement. Because if we will be talking Day of Atonement, the occurrence takes place in heaven. That is the spiritual side. But if we will be talking the material side, that is Passover week. Let's read White House Recruiter, page 24. It says, with these solemn words, the Lord warns that the slaughter, the antitypical Passover. When would be the Day of Slaughter? Antitypical Passover. When would be the blotting out of names? Antitypical Day of Atonement. But the fact is that the blotting out of names precedes the Day of Slaughter, because those whose names had been blotted out in the Lamb's Book of Life, they will be the one that will suffer such destruction. The Day of Slaughter. So, that is the reality. From that final Day of Atonement in March 27, 2021, you have still time to continue laughing, to continue ridiculing God's people, because the material side did not as yet appear on that time. But your destiny is already forever fixed. You could no longer alter the situation. Once your names will be blotted out, you could no longer alter the situation. And the statement given by the Shepherd's Rod, once our names will be blotted out, here in 12 Symbolic Code, number 3, on page 18, it says, I would like to read the statement, brothers and sisters. The only judging which the sanctuary in heaven does in regard to this is to give right for one class of the dead to arise either in the first resurrection or in the second resurrection, and to give right for one class of the living to stand on Mount Zion with the Lamb for translation, and for the other to die on at the slaughter weapons of the angels. To give right to die on the slaughter weapons. What does it mean? That once your names will be blotted out on the Lamb's Book of Life, then you are waiting for such destruction. Let me read to you the statement in track number 3 on page 67. Track number 3, page 67. The command, gather out of his kingdom all things that offend and them which do iniquity, does not mean to gather his saints from the earth into heaven. Neither does it mean to destroy the wicked from the earth. For the former are to be gathered not directly to heaven, but first into the barn, the kingdom on earth. And the latter are not to be destroyed immediately in the time of harvest, but first are to be gathered into bundles and then destroyed, as is further illustrated in the parable of the net. What does it mean? They are first to be gathered into bundles. Before they will be destroyed, they must be gathered first into bundles. Track number 3, page 67. Well, brothers and sisters, you know, deep down in my heart, sometimes I'm thinking, what shall I do that I could be able to awaken the senses of my fellow Shepherd's Rod believers? Brethren, do not look at the messenger, look at the message. I remember the statement in the Old Symbolic Code. Let me see. There's a statement given by the Shepherd's Rod in the Old Symbolic Code. There are many people who are wasting their time gazing the messenger. Let me see. 3 Symbolic Code 5 and 6 page 3. 3 Symbolic Code 5 and 6 page 3. As a secretary of the reform movement, I have seen in my observation of the field of wheat, present truth believers, that some are letting the shower pass by. They are not only failing to make use of the rain, but are even brushing from their garments the drops, fearing that it will do them harm. They see the rain falling, but rather than helping themselves to it, they are wasting their time gazing at the clouds' messengers. They are wasting their time gazing at the clouds' messengers, which carry it, thinking thus to know whether the clouds are traveling in the way in which mortal minds think right for rain, or in the way in which God made them to go drop the rain. Look at the attitude of the Bijan today. It seems that they dictated God what God will do. No, I will not accept any message if it will not originate in the headquarters by which I do fully believe. Well, brethren, that argument and reasoning is not new under the sun. It is used by the Jewish people. Why is it that Jesus Christ bypassed all of them? The temple, and God revealed only to ordinary person, John the Baptist, living solitarily in the mountain. John the Baptist is not a priest. He's not a Levite. But why is it that God chose him? And the Jewish people cannot accept it because they thought that the message must always come within the headquarters, within the temple, within the Sanhedrin. And they were wasting their time, brothers and sisters. That is the reality among the Bijan today. They were wasting their time focusing to a very minor subject, headquarters. And to all the Bijans, I invite each one of us to explain the statement in 1 TG number 9, page 5. 1 TG number 9, page 5, saying, "He shall save the tents, the humble dwellings, rather than the houses or palaces of Judah first." That is, the Lord is to save first the common people, the lighty, so that the ministry may not exalt themselves above the lighty, that all may learn to give glory to God, not to any man. Who are they that God would save first? The tents of Judah. What is the tents? Humble dwellings rather than houses or palaces. What is houses? What is palaces? Headquarters, right? That is palaces. B'Tiotep says palaces represent headquarters. So does the shepherd's rod is wrong that the people that God would save are those people by which they have no houses? What is the destiny of those who have houses, who have headquarters? Let me read to you in the old symbolic code. This is their destiny. One symbolic code, number 14, page 6. One symbolic code, number 14, page 6. As Amos says, the habitations of the shepherd shall mourn. It is obvious that Amos' prophecy is yet future. For the word habitations, places, is in the plural form, which cannot be applied to one shepherd's habitation, denomination, but to all that be in existence at that time. The term shepherds means, as understood, the same as the ancient men, which were before the house, the ministers. Testimonies for the Church, Volume 5, page 211. Note that the shepherds are not themselves to mourn, but their habitations, their houses. Who are they? The group of people that shall mourn. Those people by which under the habitations or houses, meaning to those group of or organizations by which they were boasting to their headquarters. Note that the shepherds are not themselves to mourn, but their habitations, their houses, that is the membership of their churches, which fact reveals that it will be thus at the time when the sleeping multitudes in the churches awake from their spiritual insensibility and find that the shepherds whom they have implicitly trusted for their salvation had deceived all those who followed them. One symbolic code, number 14, page 6. But who are they? The tents of Judah, those people by which they have only humble dwellings represented by tents. They have no houses, it says, or palaces. What is palaces? Headquarters. And that with what happening now, brothers and sisters. And those membership that followed the explanation of their leaders emphasizing headquarters, while in reality, they were in total ignorance concerning the proceedings in the heavenly sanctuary, not knowing that we are about to come that last and final day of atonement, and their leaders are opposing this message. Can you imagine? Not only in ignorance, but at the same time, the same with the Jewish people. They were fighting against the message. So, brethren, hoping that we will not be among those people that reject the message. We will be among those people, the 144,000 living saints, whose names had not been blotted out in the Lamb's Book of Life. Strive with all your power to be among that special company. Thank you very much for listening and viewing this program. May the good Lord bless you and have a beautiful, wonderful evening.